I believe the objective of this discussion is for me to share some of my thoughts, mainly with the upcoming young professionals. So my request to the young professionals, for them to basically think out of the box. They have to be aware of what's happening across the world. When I was going through social media, I noted that users of social media, they have posted comments to say, okay, the election is happening in the US, why we are bothered? It's true in a way, but in the context of globalization, what's happening in one part of the world would have an impact on the other parts of the world. So all these would really help you when you take decisions.
Yes.
Geopolitics is a major vast topic. In your opinion, how would you elaborate more on the topic? How would you explain the topic to others?
If you kind of require a technical definition, geopolitics is basically the study of the geography.
Okay.
In the context of politics and international relations. But then I mean, it's kind of a interpretation, but then when, as we go on with examples, I'll be able to explain, so the listeners would be able to better understand.
I see.
So the topic
for the definition.
Yes.
I see.
Geopolitics itself would not help decision making. I think it has to nice to blend with the understanding in economics, both local as well as international economics, and will really enhance the ability to take strategic decisions for the organizations that the professionals are really working. That's the context in which I think a professional, especially a professional who's into business, should study geopolitics.
So recently US election was held, you know, a major event which was held recently. How do these major international events, you know, impact us?
In fact, when I was going through social media, I noted that you know, some of these people, the users of social media, they have posted comments to say, okay, the election is happening in the US, why we are bothered, some funny statements. Then really, I mean, yeah, it's true in a way, but in the context of globalization, what's happening in one part of the world would have an impact on the other parts of the world, including Sri Lanka, including us individually. All right, now US elections, since you categorically took US elections. No, in the USA, I lived in the USA for 2 years plus. So I had the opportunity to study some of these things, you know, in a practical context. I could remember there was a presidential election during the period that I was living in the US. Before that, I was living in Africa, which gave me a different insight. Now, in the US, there are two major parties, you know, the Republican Party as well as the Democratic Party. So, last time, Joe Biden, who won the election, which had been disputed by the previous president, Mr. Donald Trump, who is representing the Republican Party, and Joe Biden happened to be a member of the, or rather the representative of the Democratic Party. You know, Barack Obama, he also represented the same party, the Democratic Party. And how it impacts us or other countries, it all depends on their foreign policy, their economic policy, and through that they can exert significant influence on what we do,
okay.
Right? And the influence or the impact could be on our corporates, on our day-to-day life, and our interest rates could get impacted, the foreign exchange rates could get impacted, and for any decision maker in the context of business and strategy, it's very important to have an understanding about these things. For instance, we take during Mr. Donald Trump's period, his relationship with China was not so good in terms of trade.
Yes.
And at the latter part of his regime, still, you know, his tenure is not complete as per the US you know, electoral system. And then he was on the verge of, you know, heading to a very sour relationship beyond even the economic ties, right? And then people were worried whether it would lead to another war,
yeah,
kind of situation between the two countries, which would bring devastation,
yeah,
in our part of the world, the Asia Pacific. So what he did, as soon as he got elected, he started imposing trade barriers to the US. He believed in something. If you take the previous president's motto, let's make US great, and his sole focus was US, and it was kind of different to the previous regime. Previous regime, they wanted to go and interfere with the affairs of other countries, and you know, you call it human rights, or you know, exerting pressure through certain economic measures or through organizations like UN, etc. But then Donald Trump's strategy was different. He did not want to go and, you know, interfere and spend the country's resources on other people's problems.
Yeah.
His main focus was the USA, and his decisions were mainly aligned in protecting the US interests, just the US, you know. Let's make America great again. And he walked the talk. In that context, he got some of the relationships damaged with the other parties, with other countries. For instance, because of this trade war between the US and China, you know, Mr. Trump, under Mr. Trump's regime, there were trade barriers, some new taxes being imposed. Then China also reacted in the same manner. They have also imposed certain duty requirements. And in that context, in certain instances, countries like us also got benefited because we had new trading opportunities with China.
Okay.
Right? So whoever who really followed these things would have really identified these opportunities and strategized their business operations to exploit some of these conditions that are happening in the world. And if you take now these 10 or 15 Asia Pacific countries, Southeast Asian countries, plus Australia, New Zealand, the China, they have entered into an economic partnership. It's called Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, right? And with that, they have entered into kind of a trade agreement.
Yeah.
India was not part of it. And USA and India entered into some understanding. So all these things would really bring either opportunities or vice versa to countries like ours. Sri Lanka is located in a strategically important position in terms of maritime, the context of maritime. So and China's heavy investment in Sri Lanka really bothers India and the USA. And to make the things worse, you know, China is now having stake in some of our land masses, Port City, down south, etc. It really bothers these two major countries.
Yeah.
Right? And these things will have an impact on our relationship, especially our trade relationship. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, two ways. even though India and USA would not be happy, they may also try to create opportunities for us. They want to keep us also happy.
Yes.
On the other hand, they are worried. They are really worried with our strong relationship with China. So these are the things that we need to study as you know, business leaders, especially young professionals who are coming up in the ladder, should develop the art of converting this knowledge into business decisions.
Okay.
Right? It's very important. Now my experience in dealing with the young professionals, they are very good at you know, the technical stuff, name it, accounting, auditing, taxation, etc. But if they really want to go up the ladder, right, they have to bring this knowledge to the boardroom.
Think outside the box.
Things are outside the box. They should be able to articulate some of these trends, developments that are happening in the international context into a business decision. They should show that knowledge when they have the opportunity to their senior management. Then they'll be able to go beyond finance and become good business leaders. Maybe CEOs, maybe one day directors, or you know, if somebody is interested in becoming entrepreneurs, these things will help them to identify opportunities and to exploit such opportunities for business purpose. So that's the importance of studying all these things. Studying the sense, not, you know, by heart in books. It's general knowledge.
Impact and everything. No?
Yes. So it's a process. Overnight you can't do it. You have to follow news. You have to read news. You have to listen to news. And you have to read good magazines. You have to talk to people who are interested in the subject. Then you can become a good strategist.
Sir, in your opinion, what would be some of the major events, you know, on the geopolitical landscape that happened recently and during the past years that impacted us, Sri Lanka, and also the developing countries?
Now we say our country is into debt, but then if you take, let's take US. USA happened to be the major economy, right? The largest economy in terms of the GDP. And USA is in debt to China. They the Chinese investment in treasury bonds and bills in the USA, it exceeds $1 trillion, right? So what happens now? If you really analyze, there's a correlation between the US Federal Reserve rates and our policy rates, right? And then you can't get away with that, because we are mainly when it comes to international trade, we are mainly dealing with the US dollars or sterling pounds or euro, but US dollar happened to be the main currency, right? And if you take the US dollar now, US dollar got strengthened during last couple of years. One of the reasons happened to be because of certain economic policy decisions taken by the previous US regime. They cut down on their imports. They wanted to start industries in their country. Their taxes has been aligned to promote that thinking, and with that the US dollar got strengthened in the market, right? When it happens, it obviously have an impact for countries like ours. Our trade account balances might get into our balance of payment, might have an impact.
Okay.
Then indirectly these things would have an impact on our inflation. Then it links to our interest rates. So this is the link, right? And let me take another example. You would have heard of Brexit, right? Brexit means Britain's exit from the European Union. So David Cameron, Prime Minister, one of the ex-Prime Ministers in the UK, he had to resign, he had to step down because of the Brexit. Then Ms. Theresa May became the Prime Minister. Now it's Boris Johnson. So what happens? David Cameron didn't like the idea of exiting from the European Union, and during the election, that was one of his mottos. Okay, we have to continue with the youth. He believed in that, but then people voted against it. So he took a decision, and he, in a respectable manner, stepped down from the position. So what happens when still it's not finalized? In case if Britain exits, what would be the impact to countries like Sri Lanka? If the UK exits from the European Union, would it create opportunities to us, or would it really bringing any bad effects to our economy, right? Now, for instance, in my view, it might bring certain advantages to countries like ours, because by being a member of the European Union, they had to prioritize getting into deals with the EU countries.
Yeah.
Right? But if they exit, they have more freedom to enter into trade agreements with countries like ours. So we will be able to exploit such opportunities. Let me take another example. Now, if you take during the USA Barack Obama's period, you know, we have been accused of human rights violations, that and this.
Yes.
And during Trump's period, you know, as I told you first, he was not interested about, you know, others' affairs much, no much of interference. But then again, this Barack Obama's, you know, party had gotten into power, so we don't know going forward what kind of challenges we would have. I don't say that, you know, we didn't have good relationship with the US. But then, in case if we again get human rights violation with a retrospective, you know, viewpoint, what happened in the past, these things would have an impact in winning orders from foreign companies. There are restrictions, you know, good companies, there are restrictions for them to enter into trade deals with the companies in those countries where if the countries are accused of human rights violations. Right? Then if you are heavily depending on your export income, your company, then if you see such a trend, you have to make certain alternative arrangements to address the situation. So these are the things.
When taking things to the near present, let's take a topic which was spoken vastly. COVID-19, you know, there were many you know, comments about it. They said you know, it was a virus which was man-made, and they said you know, it's another civil war, it's the third world war, and they said China is responsible, and you know, because, you know, China is not affected from the economic crisis which occurred due to the virus. What would be your opinion on that regard, sir?
Yes, of course, it had brought a major paradigm shift in our day-to-day life, from our day-to-day life to business to, you know, many more. Right? But whether it's man-made or not, I really don't know. I mean, you know, you'd have heard of the conspiracy theory. Right? I mean, if you are really aspired, you can create doubt in people's mind so that you can take advantage of such doubts. Right? So, you know, probably people may be trying to exploit the situation to go for their individual agendas.
Yeah.
Right? But then it's not yet proven, and making such accusations also sometimes costly. You know what happened to Australia? Australia, at the World Health Organization, made certain adverse comments against China.
Mm-hmm.
So the following week, China brought in certain trade barriers to Australia, right? And if you take Australia, they get a substantial export revenue from China. And if you take the Australian GDP, one of the contributors happened to be the education. A lot of Chinese students are studying in Australia. Not only that, this meat, then vegetables, fruits, a lot of exports from Australia to China. So now they had imposed some barriers with probably the new economic partnership, they might lift it,
mm-hmm.
but still, countries got to be careful in making such adverse remarks.
So, World Trade Organization plays a major role, on the geopolitical landscape. What would be some other regulatory bodies, to control geopolitical pressure?
It's an interesting question. Then I had to go back to the Second World War era.
Yeah.
What happened? Pre-Second World War,
mm-hmm.
there was no such organization to interfere with situations where the world peace would be impacted, right? And the Second World War brought a lot of destruction to the world. So, post-Second World War, the international institutions like the United Nations, the World, the IMF, the World Bank, such organizations been introduced or established after the Second World War, and mainly to maintain peace and to balance financing, and to avoid that kind of a destruction. That's one of the, that's the main objective of establishing these agencies.
Mm-hmm.
So, the World Trade Organization, WTO, World Health Organization, the UN, the World Bank, the IMF, So, all these organizations, they work together to ensure peace and harmony to prevail in the world. But then we should not forget the fact, who's really funding these organizations? All the major economies.
Yes.
So these organizations may be used to implement some of the agenda items of these powerful economies, that we need to be aware of that. But then they have also done very good things for the to maintain the peace and harmony in this world.
So all these events, sir, they create opportunities and some create threats to us. With regard to the recent events, what would be some opportunities and threats that were created for us and also for developing countries?
Yes, a country like ours, I believe personally, we should not be aligned with any party, any country too much, because we need everybody, right? Now we are speaking of China and India. Well, our trade relationship with China, trade relationship with India, so we have to keep them happy, that and this. But if you really go into numbers, analyze the trade account, our country's trade account, and see which countries are really giving us a trade surplus. It's not China, it's not India. In fact, we have huge trade deficits with both China and India. Actually, the trade surplus, the largest trade surplus we are getting from the transactions in the USA.
Okay.
Right? Then the second highest trade surplus we are getting from the UK. So if the customer is king, it's the US, if you really go into numbers, right? Not to play by the sentiments. That's the thing. And now, even if you take this COVID-19 situation, even if we come out of the situation, if our main trading partners are still, recovering, right? And if they have not come to their normal potential, and still we are at a bad figure.
Yes.
Why our trading partners are suffering?
Yes.
So we will not be able to earn the same income from them. So all these things are linked. And now, we have brought in restrictions to imports, etc. But I don't think that it would persist. Naturally, if you buy me, if I sell you something, you expect me also to buy something from you, right? So we can't simply close our import account and expect our exports to prevail. So it's a give and take.
Yeah.
It's a give and take. So we need to identify these things right now. Now, I mean, I believe certain measures that have been taken to avoid the balance of crisis situation in our country really appreciate you. Mm-hmm. But then going forward, probably step by step, we may have to release it. Now, especially vehicle imports.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was a good move to restrict. Some say that we have lost a substantial duty income.
Yes.
Because of that. But then when you, I mean, in terms of balancing the trade account and avoiding the balance of crisis situation, we have to protect whatever our dollar reserves, right? Then in that context, that restriction is good. Even though we lose duty income, that's something internally we'll be able to manage, right? But having said that, if you really look at our 2021 budget, there's increase in the tax revenue. The government is expecting more tax revenue. But then if you really look at, I have to mention this fact, how the government is going to bridge the budget deficit, mm-hmm. It's by issuing bonds. If you really go through the technical document, you would see. But now we have a problem there. When we say issuing bonds, you can issue foreign dollar denominated bonds, or you can raise money locally through treasury bills and bonds. But then, you know, Fitch recently downgraded our long-term foreign currency default rating to CCC, downgraded.
Okay.
So in that context, who's going to buy our bonds? Then the government will have to basically focus raising money to bridge the deficit locally.
Mm-hmm.
In which context, if you really go to the basics of economics, when it happens, obviously there's upward pressure on the interest rates, right? So this low interest regime, it would be very hard to maintain in that context. And that's why I told you this geopolitics along with economics would make a good strategist. When you take business decision, when you negotiate with banking institutions, if you carry this knowledge, it will really help you. You should be able to analyze all these things and see how it could have an impact on what we do.
Yes.
Then take decision in that context with proper rationale.
Yes. Finally, final question. In your opinion, sir, what would be some major events that would occur in the near future that would impact us in the economy?
You know, given the circumstance, right? The volatility of the things that are happening everywhere, including our country, it's high. Therefore, anything could happen anytime. Now, last year, what happened? We had this Easter attack.
Yes.
Right? A complete disruption. Nobody expected it. And this year, then the local issue, last year it was a local issue, this year international issue, right?
COVID.
Global issue. Then worst to worst. So then all these things never expected.
Yeah.
Right? So therefore anything could happen. You never know. Even one fine day somebody says there's an alien attack, I will not surprise, because you know, even that is possible.
It's possible.
But the thing is, you know, in near future events, you'll be able to really fathom if you really follow what's happening in an international context. And by looking at certain things in a reasonable manner, you will be able to project. Right? If there's a election in a major economy, by looking at the two personalities, if it is for the head of the state, their popularity, etc., then you will be able to judge, okay, you would be able to, who would win the election. And by going through their policy statements, their economic alignment, their foreign policy alignment, you will be able to understand, okay, how they would, in case if that particular person becomes the head of the state, how he would maintain his foreign policy, economic policy, what kind of impact that it would have. For instance, you know, I was living in Botswana for some time, and all of a sudden the head of the state got changed. He had a foreign policy to give job opportunities as much as possible to local people, their people.
Okay.
Which had brought in certain restrictions in issuing work permits and visas for foreign expatriates. So it had an impact on foreign expatriates. That time I had left Botswana, but then it had impact on our accountants, right? That time a huge number of accountants were going for jobs in Botswana, and from Botswana, after accumulating some money, they used to go and migrate to New Zealand, Australia, Canada, UK, and there was this clearly defined path for greener pastures for professionals. So it got disrupted, right? And then that have had an impact on our job market, maybe in a smaller way, but still see the link,
yeah.
Right? So these things are
very direct.
Yeah. So I mean, okay, since you asked this question, what would happen in future? I believe with COVID-19 challenge, this digitalization, which would the sort of technology and know-how of technology of the people, I think it got advanced with COVID-19. Something that could have happened after 2 to 3 years time, it had already now taken place. This will bring in changes to what we do, you know, certain business models, etc. Then you can't avoid the fact that both China and India are going to be very powerful economies, naturally. You know, both the countries, if you take China, 1.4 billion odd population, India almost reaching there. So, naturally, with that kind of masses, the economy would grow. There, the people have to eat and drink, they have to survive. When they do that, obviously the GDP would go up, there should be job opportunities to create jobs, there should be investments. Even if you take the corporates, multinationals, anybody would like to go to these two countries because of the market size. So there's organic growth for these two countries, right? So then China, you know, very soon they have the potential to become the largest economy, and at the moment only China is recording a positive GWP growth year on year compared to other economies. That's one. Yes, they have managed the situation. They have to feed their people in that exercise. Obviously, there's an organic growth to their economy. So this Asia Pacific region would be really powerful going forward, and would be economically powerful. Unless they disrupt this with some dirty plan, you can do it. Now, for instance, China, if you take, there are various provinces, various ethnicities. India also the same.
Yeah.
And if there's any civil unrest in one of these countries, it would be very difficult for them to manage given the size of the country. China is holding a tight hand because they have this main party, Chinese Community Party. So they don't have much of party politics. Other parties very small, not even near to the main party, China Communist Party. So in that context, they have a good hold. But in case if there's any civil unrest in China, it would be very difficult for them to manage. And at the moment they have a problem in Hong Kong, but they are with a very tight standing or rough standing, they are managing the situation. likewise, even in India, given the fact that there are so many ethnics who are living in India, they also can't afford to have any civil unrest. So they have to manage these internal affairs nicely for them to reach their targets. And whatever happens in these major economies, it would obviously have an impact on us. So we had to nicely comprehend, you know, where they are going and how things are developing in these major economies, and be aware of those conditions and consider those in our decision making process. And the other thing is, I believe, I wish and pray our policymakers would maintain you know, the policy framework in a prudent manner to maintain harmonious relationship with all these countries, yeah. Not without aligning with anybody,
yeah.
Which is very important for countries like ours.
Yeah. So finally, would you like to add something extra on the topic?
Yeah, I mean, I believe the objective of this discussion is, you know, for me to share some of my thoughts, mainly with the upcoming young professionals,
yes.
You know. And now I play different roles, you know. I'm the managing director of a consulting company, Bo Stevens Consulting Private Limited, which has given me the opportunity to deal with top tier some of these entrepreneurs, you know, in terms of providing required professional services to them. I mean, these links are really helpful, and these our discussions when it comes to my work helps me to learn also from them. As much as, you know, we are providing services, they are also really competent and knowledgeable people. The way that they, the entrepreneurs, how they look at things and how they analyze things, it's giving me a different perspective. Then as the chairman of an insurance company, which is a regulated entity, it's giving me a different perspective. That's why I spoke about interest rates. You know, we are highly vulnerable for interest rates, and we have accumulated reserves, and we have invested these reserves. We have to give a return to our shareholders. We have to satisfy certain solvency margins. So when you to balance all these things, you need to at the top, you need to have this knowledge, this thinking, right? Even as the chairman, to direct the board in the right direction, it's very important for me to have understanding of these things. Then as a director of a bank, again a regulated entity, again a bank is highly vulnerable for macroeconomic conditions locally as well as you know, certain foreign economic conditions.
Yes. It's also managing that.
Yeah. So it's a different role, yeah. Honorary role which I play. And yeah, even now if you take my role as a council member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants, as you know, I'm in charge of the examinations. I was worried initially we could not hold our examinations. Then I was personally studying how other countries have been conducting examinations in this context. How UK had done it, how Australia had done it, and now we are going to have our virtual examinations. I'm pretty much happy, you know, in that context we are a bit ahead,
yeah.
Right? And we have taken certain decisions, calculated risks we are going to take. So likewise, that's also, you know, geopolitics, how other countries political system facilitated education, how other geographies, other landmasses, the people there, how they have taken decisions. And if they have done something, obviously people will find out and we will get pressure. Okay, so and so have done these things, they have conducted things like this in this manner, why are we not doing it? So but then before they do, we are also, you know, we also have to act proactively. And yes, now day before yesterday we had I'm a council member of the University of Moratuwa, so technology oriented university, and at the meeting I made a request as an accountant. I told, you know, I'm a I'm not a technology-oriented person. I'm an accountant, but then I feel we should introduce satellite technology, you know, or education linked to satellite technology to the university. And I believe it's high time for us to start a project in launching our own satellite. Probably the university can give the leadership. So this is out of the box thinking. And to have such thought, of course, you should love your country also. We like to see this country, you know, prosper and progress, and the next generations would be benefited. Yeah, I mean, in that context, we have to do justice to whatever the responsibilities or roles that we hold. And these responsibilities and positions are really huge burdens. It's not just to enjoy the glory. And people give these things for us to perform a certain task. And we have to make sure we deliver the goods. And for us to deliver the goods, we should know things first, right? So my request to the young professionals, they have to basically, for them to basically think out of the box, they have to be aware of what's happening across the world. And not only that, study things that would be beyond our interested subject area. You know, I'm reading about the space, the technology, the time, how this world started. You know, I read, I like to read Stephen Hawking's writings, you know, and the Big Bang theory, the Albert Einstein's writing, the theory of relativism. So then only you will be able to open up your mind. So all these would really help you when you take decisions.
Thank you so much, sir. So that actually brings an end to the program. Thank you, Mr. Subhas Singh, for your valuable time. It was actually a great honor to have you on our platform. Thank you so much. Stay connected with Executive Talks to hear more from the pillars of our own corporate world.